All right, let's turn to 1 Peter. We left off in chapter 2. We want to look at verse 9 this go round. Verse 9 really bears out the things that verse 5 was pointing to. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a people of his own, or a peculiar people, which there's no question about that around here. They don't get any more peculiar than this people. That ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. All right. There's so much in this verse, but let's look at this concept of a royal priesthood. The scriptures in Revelation also says that we are, we are kings and priests. But in reality, when this says a royal priesthood, this means that, and when it says we're kings and priests, the actual translation of that isn't that we are all kings, but that we are a kingdom of priests. That's the actual Greek translation there. And it's pointing to the reality that Christ has made a king, a bunch of priests, his kingdom. In other words, you can't be in the kingdom of God unless you're a priest, and you can't be a priest unless you're offering up the acceptable sacrifice. Well, that's an interesting way of looking at it, isn't it? Well, that is the way to look at it. That the citizens of who make up this kingdom are all priests. And that means that the kingdom is not just made up of Christians, because it says we're a kingdom of priests. And those references, in most part, are, when it's talking about a royal priesthood and all that, it's simply referring to the fact that the kingdom of God is made up of priests. And that if you're, that, and in other words, there's not people that are in the kingdom who are not priests. That means that there's not some people that are in the kingdom, but they have no intention of offering up Christ. They have no intention that Christ come out of them and honoring the Father constantly. They're going to live a good life, or they're going to live a committed life, or they're going to live their life in ministry. And it's pretty much about, and that's really, now think about this. People always talking about, like in the book of Revelation, Jesus is on the throne and everyone is around the throne. In many people's mind, they're picturing, you know, one day I'm going to stand before God, and the main thing going on is that God's going to, you know, judge if my ministry was effective or not. And I'll get some real cool rewards if it was. But in truth, long before that or anything else, everyone is gathered around and here's the Lamb. And, I mean, the elders are taking off their crowns and throwing it at his feet. They're not going, you know, I earned this crown. I'm good. You know, and you see that jewel? I got that for going to the mission field for several years. You know, and you see this jewel over here? You know, I mean, that's what people talk about, crowns. I mean, jewels in your crown and, you know, all the rewards that you're going to get on that sense. But those who truly see Jesus, they take anything that they might have earned or is honored, and they throw it at Jesus' feet, and they say this, "Thou art worthy." You're not going to do that unless you're a priest. You're not going to do that unless you understand the acceptable sacrifice, and unless you understand what it is that pleases the Father. You're not going to push your way through the crowd and push Jesus out of the way and you know, talk about what you did or what you gave up. You know, well, I gave up, you know, Like I said, you know, I gave up my CDs. Well, I gave up this. Well, I gave up that. He's going to say, but did you give Christ? See? Because pride can get in when you're giving stuff up. I know God's pleased with me because I gave up. No, God's pleased with His Son, and He's pleased with you when you give Him His Son, because that means you're a priest of God. That's what means you're a priest. And so this whole concept about priesthood is related to being a kingdom. Your occupation, let's put it this way, your occupation in the kingdom is to continually give the Father Christ. That's your occupation. Well, you know, no, I'm an evangelist. No, that might be your calling, but it's not your occupation. You might be called to minister in evangelism, but you, if you're in the kingdom, are a priest, and you're still supposed to be giving the Father the Son. Does that make sense? You know, but no, we want to forget about Jesus. We want to forget about priesthood in any real level. And the most important focus is not the priesthood. The most important focus is my calling. Why do I exist on this earth? Let me find the thing I exist for that pleases God. Well, if it's not by Christ, you know, you can offer up your ministry. You can offer up stuff all the time. And if it's not by Christ, then you are an evangelist that is not in the kingdom. Because all the kingdom is not made of evangelists. It's made of priests, you see. Now, this should be sort of clear and simple. It's not really that difficult. When you preach, you give them Christ. You don't give them yourself. People don't need more of me. I don't need more of me. I'm sick of me. I mean, I am. I don't want, you know. And, if I really believe that, if you really believe that, and you really don't, you know, and I'll just say it like this. I mean, there are better ways of saying it. But if you really don't like yourself, but you love Jesus, then the last thing you want to do is perpetrate this horrible thing on people by giving them you. This ungodly, yucky sacrifice that we're not only throwing, you know, because the priest ate the sacrifice. You not only throw it up on the altar and want God to accept it, but you want everybody else to eat it. And if it's not Christ, what are you touching? What are you involved in? What is touching you? It can't be what it's supposed to be. It cannot be. It cannot be. It is devoid of the eternal Spirit. And it really is just temporal doing. To the glory of God, of course. But it's us. It is the unacceptable sacrifice trying to give glory to God in our ministry. You got to be a priest first. You got to be a priest first. And see, now, you know, I think I've got it in here somewhere, but think about that concept. In the Old Testament, there were prophets, and there were priests, and there were kings, and there were people. But in the New Covenant, if there is a prophet, he's a priest. If there are people, they're priests. Amen? So, you know, you say, well, I don't know what my ministry is around here. You know, I want to be an apostle to Acts. You know, why not just be a priest and offer, and see, you don't even have to do anything for here. You're doing it to the Father. And you know what that means? That may mean everything going wrong, and you're still giving the Father the Son. That may mean that you don't do very good in your ministry because your focus is on giving the Father the Son. That may mean that you fail at times in ministry, but you never fail in giving the Father his Son. Does that make any sense to anybody? I mean, does that sound that you could actually fail at your calling and succeed at your being? And that is, I'm a priest that will give the Father the Son. Well, you know, I mean, God, you know, imagine this. Imagine God actually stirring up and messing up your ministry to make you look bad so that he'd see if you're a priest that's going to give him the Son. But we wouldn't want to look bad. I got news for you. God will do that. Don't forget about the devil. You know, the devil's trying to make me look bad. God knows you already look bad. He's trying to make you realize it. He's not shocked. We do something wrong. We go, I'm so shocked. I did that. I can't believe it. I'm sorry that I failed. And he goes, you are a failure. We go through all this stuff, and he knows exactly what we are. What he's wanting is not for you to be successful in what you do so that everybody says, oh, what a good steward, or, oh, you do such a good job for Jesus. A priest doesn't do a good job for Jesus. A priest does a good job in giving the Father Jesus. Isn't that right? That's what a priest does. I'm not giving you something. I'm not holding back. I'm going to give you the Son. Full out. Well, God will see to it that you're put in a bad light sometime. And that's okay. It is okay. It's hard to, I mean, it's easy to sit here and nod and say, but I'm telling you, you get to a place where it's okay. Because if you're giving the Father the Son, and you know you're giving the Father his Son, then it really doesn't matter what anybody thinks or says, does it? It really doesn't. I mean, it doesn't. Because most people that would have a hard time with it aren't really in tune with the eternal Son. They're just in tune with the circumstances. And so if those same people will honor you in the flesh, they'll kill you in the flesh. Because if they're in the flesh, you know, and that's why just a very short span of Jesus' life, I mean, within days, they're shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King. And a few days later, they're shouting, Crucify him, crucify him. They don't know what's up. They're up and down and up and down and up and down. Jesus is the only one who's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's in tune with his Father. And when they're all honoring him and putting all these palm branches down in front of him, he's not sitting there going, yeah, I'm finally getting the, you know, what's due me. He knows what's in all flesh. He knows where they're headed. He knows that they're up now, but they'll be down in a minute, and you can't bank anything on that. Am I right or wrong? It is the truth. It is the truth. You know, we get, you know, God does something good in a church or this or that, and we get all excited. Oh, the Lord is so good. Everything's wonderful and everything. And then something goes bad. And we go, it's like we're up on the roller coaster. And I mean, we're just, you know, heaving and, And, you know, trust me, being on that roller coaster and heaving ain't fun for the people in front of you. You know, hey, dude, you know, well, that's just mankind. That's human. I don't get down on that personally because I know, in that sense, I could say, I don't fully know this, but I mean, I think I know what's in all flesh, and that is, we are not Christ. And if it's not Christ formed in us, then we are going to be up and down. And so it's like, you know, It's like when they came into the garden to kill Jesus, to take him away to the cross. He didn't go, "You idiots! I've healed most of you. I've fed, you know, but you were in the 5,000 that I fed, and so were you, and you, and you, and you, and you, you know, your mom was sick, and I healed her and everything. I can't believe you're doing this to me. This ain't right." Jesus didn't do that. He didn't get all wrangled over it. He just said, as long as it's flesh, it's flesh. But he did do something. He gave the Father his Son. The life of the Son within him. Gave it to the Father. Into your hands I commend my spirit. So, I say all that just to say, don't trust in outward appearance. Don't trust in what you see. Don't trust. Don't. If there's somebody around here that's real lovey-dovey and real kind to you, you better make sure it's Christ that's doing that through them, because the same thing that's kind can turn and hate you. That's human love. Okay? So don't get caught up in circumstances. Get caught up in the Lord. Just be with the Lord. Always, always want to give the Father the Son, and you'll be a priest. And that is an eternal relationship. It is. Evangelist is not an eternal relationship. Right? Think it through. It's not. But a priest, yes, it is. You will always be giving the Father his Son. I like that. And you know what? It puts you in a position to live eternal life now, instead of living for the ministry and the job and the need. You're about the Father's business, not God's ministry. See the difference? Jesus said, he didn't say, "I must be about the ministry. I am called as a minister. I know I'm 12. But I must be about the ministry." He didn't say that. He said, "I must be about my Father's business." There was an intimacy there. There was a connection. There was a heart connection. There was a sense of oneness and a sense of you know, it's not my pleasure or my beating myself that pleases you. It is, I must be about my Father's business. What's his concern? That's all that becomes important. All right, so here it says, an holy nation, a peculiar people, or a people of his own, that you should show forth the praises of him that called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Some of you may have a Bible that has a margin there. The word praises, if you look in the margin, it says excellencies. There is another translation that says virtues. The word praises is not even close in the Greek. It's not even close. What we get from that is, okay, I'm going to show forth the praises of Jesus. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus that, you know, my car made it to where I needed to go and I didn't need to refuel. Praise Jesus that, you know, I got a splinter in my hand and I was able to get it out and I'm not going to die of an infection. You know, praise Jesus. And we think, and that, you know, look at me. I'm a priest. Praise Jesus. I had a flat and somebody came along and helped me. Boy, what a priesthood. Folks, the word praise is there. In fact, yeah, it's, like I said, in the margin. It is showing, listen to just what the margin of this says, if it's excellencies. We as a priesthood are showing forth the excellencies of Christ, not of us. So instead of me showing my human love, I show forth his love. Instead of me showing forth my human patience, I show forth the more excellent patience. Christ. Again, you're given the acceptable sacrifice, but it is a contrast of, and especially with the translation here, it is a contrast of simply us praising God and that being part of the ministry of the priest, or us praising God by Christ, if you understand what I mean. I feel Jesus in me. He's lifting my hands now. He's making me move. Oh, I'm praising God by Christ. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about showing forth His excellencies in how we live and move and have our being, how we relate to people. That, I don't know, sometimes you see these shows and some girl or some guy is real, and these little stars go everywhere. I see stars going everywhere when somebody is just sparkling with Christ and they're not self-focused and they're not worried about themselves and they're not all wrapped up in life circumstances. Fear. And all these, they're not caught up in that. They're caught up in showing forth Christ and His excellencies. And they're just spreading that eternal universe around. And everyone else is, oh my God, what are we going to do? This thing's a mess. I don't know how to fix it. I don't know how to do this. I don't know what I'm going to do. How many trials have you been through, and those are past. But we never go, I've been a Christian, I've been through 287,000 crises, and they're all past. So I think I'm going to trust God this time. We get in a brand new and go, I don't know nothing about this one. What am I going to do? Oh no, it can't possibly end up being eternal Well, it can't possibly if you're looking to the outward Jesus on a throne somewhere to fix everything. But if you're looking for the Jesus on the throne of your heart, if you give God the Son, if the circumstance never changes or gets better, you've already done the most glorious thing. You've already honored Him to the highest honor. The most excellent honor. When you get into that, folks, we're talking about the high praises. The high praises of God. Because it's Christ. It's Christ that's bringing Him glory. So this says it, that you may show forth the excellencies of Him. It didn't say that you'd preach them. Well, I want to tell you about the excellencies of Jesus. I know you're going to like this because this is going to please God, me talking. Now, I know when I leave here, you're going to see the old man. The goat life is going to come out of me instead of the lamb. I know, but you know what? This is going to be an excellent sermon. Excellent. You'll be digging this. If our ears are attuned to hearing the right thing, we'll be pleased with that. But if our heart wants Jesus, we'll never be satisfied with just hearing the truth from me or anybody else. You'll never, ever be satisfied until the Holy Spirit is feeding you the bread of heaven constantly, Christ Himself, and you're feeding on that. You'll never be satisfied. You'll always have to come back and have somebody else feed you, Milk from a woman's breast is nothing more than her eating food herself and digesting it and breaking it all down into her body and putting it in a form where a little baby can eat. That's all it is somebody else has eaten it and broken it down so that you can get it. Well, there comes a time when you need to be weaned from the breast. That's in the scriptures. Weaned from the breast. There comes a time. Paul said, you still have need of milk. What does he mean? It's not just saying simple truths. He's saying you still don't have the divine pipeline to the Lord where you're drawing constantly from his life, from the Holy Spirit, and not just because he doesn't, you know, in one sense he does, but in one sense, the Holy Spirit doesn't come and give you sermons. You know, like the Holy Spirit shows up and says, "Hey, Randy, I got a sermon for you today." "Oh, really? Cool. Lay it on me, man. But make sure it's good and it really impresses." He's not, that's religion. He wants to somehow connect us into Christ and get a flow working between us and Jesus. That's it. He's not just trying to give a religious sermon for a meeting in a house. You know, anything that, you know, I've told this story, but some of you haven't heard it. But a long, long time ago, I was in the ministry. I was a pastor of a church. And I found that my duties were so many that the only time I went to the Word, the only time I went to the Scriptures was to get a sermon. Because I had, you know, Sunday coming up, and I was going to have to preach. So I'd go get in the Word, and I'd only go there to get a sermon. And one day, I realized, my God, this is pitiful. I said, I never get into the Word anymore just to spend time with Jesus, just to have the Holy Spirit just open up the Word and open up his heart and just say, and start showing me the Lord and me just going, you know, and not having to get something and then, you know, jump up and go, man, I got to share this with you. But me saying, you know, I don't want to share that with you. That's between me and him. That's between me and the Lord. This is about life. This isn't about a sermon. And I repented and I told the Lord, I'm never going to go to the Scriptures just to get a sermon again. Now, that's a pretty bold thing to do when you're in the ministry, because I mean, I meant it. And I thought, man. But I just said, I want my relationship to be more. And if I have to get up in front of people and say, you know what, I don't have a clue, then I would do that. Well, ever since I've done that, he's shared more than I could ever share. I probably have enough, if you want to go by sermons and stuff that he shared with me, I probably have enough to last till I die. Probably written down and in my computer. You know? I mean, I have so much, but you know what? I don't want to share something I got back then, yesterday or day before. I want to share what God tells me, and I want to share what's life. And that may mean, you know, that may mean not having something to share with in a conference or whatever, but having that face-to-face with the Holy Spirit in the Word where you just go, I don't care if I ever preach another sermon. I'm just happy to be with you, Jesus. I just love you, Jesus. I just love you. I just love you so much. I just love being with you. I don't love being a minister. I love being, you know, I love your voice. I love your eyes. I love your face. I love your heart. I love everything about you. You overwhelm me instead of going, oh, this is a great sermon. This will overwhelm you. You know, you just give it up that we might show forth the excellencies of him. Show forth. I guess one of my greatest fears is that when I get to the end of my life, I will have raised up many people who better understand this teaching, but have no real sensitivity to the Lamb and to the life. Not really. That it's not people showing forth Christ. It's just people can, you know, we got the best talkers in the nation. I mean, wouldn't that be disappointing? I mean, it'd be like, what was the point of even existing? You want children. You know what I mean? In spirit, you want children. You want family. You want like kind. You don't care if they go out and change the world. You don't care about that. You don't care if they, you know, what you want is something that knows your heart because it knows his heart and because it knows your heart, that is really more about loving and being one with him than it is about anything else. And loves the opportunity to just decrease so that he might increase. Just loves it. Not goes with the Lord. Okay. And because here's us. Well, I'm going to go with the Lord in this circumstance. What is that? If he's your life, you're going to go with the Lord. You know, you have to go with the Lord if that's not your life, but something that you've chosen as your occupation or your choice in this situation. I'm going to go with the Lord this time. Well, you know, no, it's when, you know, the Bible says Jesus made himself of no reputation. It's when you see the incredible beauty. I'm looking at a throne now. Don't get deceived yet. Let me finish. The incredible beauty of this throne. The lower seat. It is just, it's like you cut a beeline to get to that place. This is where the Lamb Spirit shines, the nature of Christ. This is where incredible fragrance is going up to the Father. You know, it just glitters and goes. I mean, it has nothing on it. It's as plain as it can be. But there are these eyes of Jesus, these eyes of the Father, these eyes of the Spirit, the eyes that have been formed in you, where it's just like the most gorgeous seat. You know. And somebody says, well, here, you know, here's a, you know, the head seat is open. And if you go quick enough, I bet you can get to it. And you're just going, I don't want it. I'm not after that. When I sit down, I want the Father to be pleased. You know? Not by how I eat or whatever, but in the spirit in which I carry myself. Well, to test that, and because when it's all said and done, the test is it the acceptable sacrifice? The test of a true priest is it God's fire, or is it, strange fire? If you're familiar with the Old Testament. What is it? The test of it is that. So when it's all said and done, it doesn't matter about the higher seat, what you do. Well, here's the thought. The more reputation I have, the more I'll be able to honor God. That's an actual thing. People say, well, if you have a bad reputation. Whereas, you know, I was thinking about that scripture the other day. Maybe I can find it, and maybe I can't. But that reputation thing, and we thinking that that's so important. Come on, Lord, help me, because I was just thinking about the scriptures. This is Paul. He says, now I pray to God that you do no evil. Now listen, I pray to God that you do no evil, not that we should appear approved. You know, every one of them. I mean, Daniel, thrown in the lion's den because he was honoring God. But it looked like he was a bad person. Now I pray to God that you do no evil. Not that you should be approved. We're not doing this for approval's sake. We're not trying to build our reputation. And if I have a good reputation, then I bring him more honor. But if I have a bad reputation, I don't bring him honor. Now that is the common thinking in the church, is it not? If I have a bad reputation, I don't bring him honor. But the better my reputation, the more honor I bring. But let's consider that for a minute. What if the true honor to the Father was to give him his Son? I mean, really, really give him his Son. And that meant the lowest seat and they chain you to it and beat you. When you could have taken a higher seat, worked your way up, and gotten back into approval. You could manipulate people, or you could make people, you know, like you. You could go out of your way to do things to make people to like you, so that they will like you based on your flesh, so that you can use a better reputation to honor God. But to do that would be to, I'm increasing and he's decreasing. And if God, you know, the truth is, promotion cometh neither from the east or the west. Promotion cometh from the Lord. That's what the scriptures say. If God wants to bring you up, he can do it. And if he's getting more Jesus than sitting right there, where was the place? Look through the scriptures quickly. Where are the places of greatest honor? Lion's den for Daniel? Prison? No, dungeon for Joseph? A cross for Jesus? The highest places of honor in God. Do you see it? Well, no. I wouldn't want to go there. I wouldn't want to be rejected. I wouldn't be considered, because it would ruin my witness. Never mind. I could really hammer that one, but I'm not going to do it. Now, I pray to God that you do no evil, not that you should appear approved. The question is, and you know, he makes it clear all through the scriptures, he also would that you do no good. He not that you just do no evil. I would that you do no good either. I would that you be crucified and that Christ be your life. And the proof of that is the whole context of chapter 12 from which he's coming. My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. God saying to Paul, I am going to limit you. I'm going to send the devil into your life and limit you to see how you handle it. I'm going to make it uncomfortable for you, and I'm going to make you, you know, Paul said that my infirmity, which was in my flesh, you did not despise. Apparently, you know, some people say that it was an eye problem, that he had running eye sore and stuff like that. You know, he's up there preaching, you know, looked like, Night of the Living Dead. Instead of cross for the living dead, you know, and my speech and my presence in front of you were contemptible. That's what he says. You know, turn in your Bible. You know, give me someone who goes, and the Lord said, you know, and you know, walks around strutting. God, y'all better just thank God, I'm not God. Because I would just slap them down, so, you know. Just, you know, if nothing else, get up every morning and say, I thank God Randy's not God. No, the honest truth is, I do have a lot of patience with that. And I know that a lot of people are helped, and they're being brought along the way, and God can use anything, and he can. The goal is not to be down on everything. But sometimes you have to draw a contrast. The goal is to lift up Christ. And there is a contrast when we are working to build our reputation instead of being of no reputation and being happy with that, you know. It's like God says, okay, I have a new assignment for you, Randy, or whoever. Here are your papers. You will now be made of no reputation, hated, despised, looked down upon. And I want you to give me the son during the whole thing. You know what? If God actually did that to us, we'd go, oh, yes, sir, amen, I'm with you, wouldn't we? If we knew that he would give us that assignment, man, we'd jump on that back. Oh, you bet, man. And somebody say, hey, stupid, idiot, jerk guy. And you'd go, Lord, just bless them. But when we don't know that that is our assignment in life and somebody does it, we go, well, that's not fair. Man, I shouldn't be put in this situation. Why are these things happening? And it's not God, because God loves me. And, you know, it's so-and-so. It's this place. It's these people. It's Debbie. Or whoever. Look around you and pick the one that God assigned. He gave them the papers. Said, your job is to irritate to no end so-and-so. Do it heartily as unto the Lord. Well, you know, because we didn't get the memo. Then we just think everything's out of control. This is all out of control. We're not a priest. Do you understand what I'm saying? You can't react that way and be a priest. A real priest, a true godly priest, a holy, holy meaning set apart for this purpose. You can't be that. You're not that. You are all wrapped up in life circumstance and you got some false belief that this is all about you and your reputation and for you to look good and for you to be okay. And when it's not, it is really just give the Father his son. And God can at any time. He can at any time change people's hearts, open the prison doors. Here comes Joseph out. He's next under Pharaoh. Now, we think that's what he really has planned for us. When in reality, what he has planned for, he doesn't do that until you're willing to sit in a dungeon and be with him. Honestly, he doesn't. Because then when he does, he lifts, you know, you up and, you know, takes you to that place. You don't go, yeah, I knew I was coming here. I deserve it. And I'm going to use every ounce of the power I got to make the people that put me in that dungeon miserable. And I thank God he gave me the power to do that. And that's why he gave me the power, because he wants me to hurt people who were God's vessels to help bring me to an end that Christ may live in me. See that? Do you see what I just said? We're ready to crucify the ones that God sent to help us come to an end of ourselves. Well, I don't like so-and-so. Big deal. You know? Do you love Jesus? Well, I love the Jesus of the resurrection. Well, look closely on that throne and you'll see a lamb slain, a little lamb slain. You still love the resurrection? Because it's not, you know, you can read it in the book of Revelation. It's not the lion of the tribe of Judah. They're crying, saying, who hath won the victory and everything, and saying, where is he? And somebody says, behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, he hath won the victory. And John turns, and he doesn't see a lion on the throne going, yeah! He sees a little lamb as though he had been slain. That's Jesus still in resurrection. We can't even imagine that. Do not picture a little fluffy lamb sitting on that throne going, bah, you know, and we're going, oh, he's so cute. Picture a gutted, opened up, bloody lamb with his tongue hanging out, a slain lamb laying there, and go, that's my Lord, that's who I follow. What am I, a little too dramatic for you tonight? Some of you got looks on your face like, my God. Hopefully. I never know what I'm doing, so sometimes I look at the... But I mean, I'm giving you a picture of honestly what the Holy Spirit gave me, because I went through this period of time where I was so in love with the Lamb, but he was this cute little fluffy little, you know, thing with a little fluffy tail that, you know, was just like, you know, oh, I just love you, Jesus, you know. You see the pictures of, you know, sometimes people holding a lamb and stuff like that, you know. I've got a picture in my office. I don't have it hung up, but of Jesus holding a little lamb, you know, and that's us, you know. We're, Jesus is holding me, I'm his little lamb, and basically, you know, he's cuddling and everything. Folks, if you're a lamb in the kingdom of God, you're going to the altar. Your purpose for existing, the reason Israel was an agricultural nation was to raise up lambs to take and to crucify in type and shadow of Christ. Not to hug and to hold and go, oh, you know, Jesus, you know. I mean, that's what the picture looks like. He's just holding his little lamb and petting and, you know, and everything. And the lamb you ought to see. I mean, it's got eyelashes. You know, it's looking up at Jesus like, you know, I just love being in your arms. And, you know, if it was really Jesus, he's looking down at it going, well, soon you're going to the altar and we will gut you like a stuck pig. Yes. To the glory of God. Are you with me? What? That's bad. Yeah, well, when I slice your throat, you won't be saying bad anymore. Folks, we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. But in all these things, we are more than conquerors. But it doesn't mean, if you read that in Romans 8, it's not saying that he'll get you out of it. He's saying in all of these things, nakedness, peril, all of those things. I mean, it says, I am persuaded, this is Paul. You know, I'm persuaded that neither height nor depth, you know, principalities nor power, nakedness, peril, none of these things shall separate me from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. And then, you know, we start, you know, all of a sudden we don't have any money and we can't buy any clothes and, you know, we're walking around with rags and everything else. Well, God doesn't love me anymore. No, and all these things were more than conquerors. We are. Yeah, that's where you go. It's not what I have. It's who I have that makes me happy. You know, I have Jesus. And Paul said this, I've learned in all things to be content, whether to be abased and do without and suffer need. He didn't say have some need. He said suffer it. Or to be exalted and to, you know, have blessings. And then he said this, I can do all things. I can do without and I can be blessed. And I'm still with Jesus. Circumstances don't make anything. I'm content because my contentment is to be with the Lord. You know, look at Watchman Nee, spent the last 20 years of his life in prison, never got out from that point, never saw his wife again, but he was with the Lord. With the Lord. I want to be with the Lord. And I want to be with the Father, and I want to give him the Son, and I want to do it every day, and I want to be wrapped up in his face and his eyes, not dirt and earth. The Lord is beautiful. His heart is beautiful. He's not evil. He doesn't, you know, and I'll try to close with this because I know the time's getting short. You ever heard someone quote this or seen the scripture on a plaque? It says, it's taken from Jeremiah, and it says, I know the plans that I have for you, plans of peace and not of destruction. Or what, evil, yeah, something like that. You're familiar with that scripture? I know my plan for you. Plans of peace and not of evil. Have you ever read the context of that? The context of that is he's about to send them into captivity for 70 years. That's the context of that scripture. That is. I'm not making that up. It is, you know, we never read that, so we pull one scripture out and we go, you know, it's we've got these little boxes that people take the scriptures and they cut up the Bible and then they pick out the favorite ones and they put it on a little thing and then you have your spiritual horoscope. You know, you pull out one every day and go, I know my plans for you, plans of peace and not of evil. And we go, it's going to be a good day today. You know, it doesn't go on. You flip it over on the back and says, however, I'm fixing to send you into captivity. Take everything you got away from you. I'm fixing to rip and tear, baby. You won't find that there. You won't find the rest of the scriptures. You know, it's just a cut up version of the Bible. Why don't we just read the Bible? I mean, you know what I mean? Why are we reading a little, you know, and they make these little bread, they look like bread. Bread for the day or something like that. It's been so long since I've, daily bread. I wonder what I'm going to get today. Well, I'll tell you what you're going to get, the cross. I can assure you, you know. You know, we were talking about Kelly had been sharing in their earlier class, and I heard him talking just a few minutes ago about, you know, David dancing before the Lord with all his might and everything. We used to sing that song around here, as David, da, 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 you know what I mean? And I remember one time I was leading worship, and I stopped the whole thing, and I said, you know what, if we're going to dance as David danced, and we need to all take off our clothes. Let's get, because that's why you dance before the Lord. I mean, that's it. And, you know, but we're as David did. I said, well, join in. You know, how scriptural are we? But we've got this Christian culture thing. And it has nothing to do with the Lamb. It has nothing to do with priesthood. It has nothing to do with the truth. It's pulling a scripture out here and just dancing, you know, like this, you know. And that's how David danced. And that's our version of it, you know. Or, you know, claiming, you know, being able to get through a trial because I know my thoughts towards you, thoughts of peace and not of evil. And we have to make that say, God's going to take care of me and I'm not going to go through anything. He doesn't, you know what? He doesn't just want to put you through something. He wants you to be with him, and it's called an opportunity, and we keep cursing it and cursing everybody who God uses to bring it. Shame on you. We need to be so in love with Jesus that we just love one another. I'm serious. Just so in love with Jesus that you're not moved by circumstances. You just love. You'll always love. It's just who you are. You look at, you know, well, they hurt me. God, man, I know hurt. I understand hurt. I understand when you feel like somebody shoved a machete here and just ripped your open, and you just can't hold your own guts in, hurting. But when you love, you just love, don't you? You just always will, and then nothing changes. You just love. And it's a beautiful thing. Well, they hurt me beyond repair. No? No? Because when that went into me, it might have ripped my soul, but it didn't touch Jesus. Jesus was hanging there and he says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Just forgive them, Father. They don't know. If they knew, it might be different. But if they just really don't know, then it's just forgive them, you know. I mean, if they're Judas, what did Jesus do when Judas came up? Judas kissed him on the cheek. Jesus called him friend. You think Jesus was a hypocrite or just using flattery? No. Jesus loved him. You know, if it's betrayal, that's one thing. If it's just people don't really know what's going on, and then you just love them. The problem is, we want to attribute malice to everybody and everything because we want to be comfortable and we don't like to be made to look bad. And that's a shame. Because how can you be a priest? How can you take upon the increase of Christ and the decrease of yourself and not embrace rejection? You know, it would be easier from the very beginning just to give it all up for Jesus than to slowly mete it out and have it ripped from your hands, you know, okay, take it then. You know, and then spend your whole life never really entering in to this thing, but just dreading the next time when he spots something else that you like. You know, and living your whole Christian life like that. What's he going to take next? Just go to the cross. Just go to the altar and die and give up you, and then he can have everything. But if you don't, then you're always fighting for this and, you know, well, they look better than me and I don't like that. Where's Jesus in that? Where's Jesus in that? Come on, be honest with me. Where is Jesus in that? How about having joy that they look better than you? I mean, really, real joy, real joy. Yes. Well, that only comes by this lamb being formed in us. It's the only way you'll give that lamb is he has to be formed in you first. That's how you give the lamb, on the altar of your own heart. So if you struggle with all these things constantly, there's only one answer. Your prayer is one thing, not help my ministry or help me in this circumstance. Your prayer is one thing. God, conform me to the image of Christ. And you don't give up on that. You say, well, I've been praying that for 2 years and I'm no different, so I think I'm just going to get lax. What is that going to accomplish? Now you're going to move into being a carnal Christian or worse than that, a Pharisee. Keep the fire burning. Go after God with all your heart. If I'm not conformed today, then may I be conformed tomorrow. You know, he cometh in an hour you think not. Maybe you'll see him by revelation tomorrow, you know, but we give up. And so we say, well, where is the sign of his coming? I don't see Jesus. I'm not being changed. I'm not being conformed. So then we just go on and say things are as they always have been. I mean, I'm just quoting scripture here. You know that, don't you? I'm quoting scripture here. You know, things have just been from the way they've been from the beginning. There's no change in me. And so then we're not looking for his coming anymore. And we just sort of give up. And now it's no longer conformed to the image of Christ. It's dealing with things. Oh Lord, deal with so-and-so, this thing within me that should have died, or deal with the place or my boss or, you know what I mean, my mom or dad or, you know, kids or something. And we just slip back into marrying and giving in marriage and eating and drinking and as it was in the days of Noah. So the flood comes upon them. God wants to reveal his son in you. Do you want it? Do you want him? God wants that so bad. It just is the incredible delight that he would get his son out of you. So he's with you. He is just, you know, he hadn't got hacked off and it quit. You got lazy or tired and quit. So I pick it back up. Let's go for God. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we just pray that the living reality, His name is Jesus, will be formed in us. Lord, not religion, not even good, deeper life religion, but that we may know Jesus. And in knowing Him, that we may be changed into that same image so that when people come to us, they meet Jesus, not in some religious way because we act spiritual, but because that nature is there to love, to forgive, to go the extra mile, to take the slap on the cheek and to turn the other cheek. Lord, whatever, that's what the person would say, whatever it takes, however many slaps it takes till they get ashamed of slapping, then help us, Father. In Jesus' name. Let me just, I normally would just walk off and right here. I remember when I was in Bible school reading a book, and it was talking about the martyrs in Rome, and there